Okay, so hi, everyone. Today, I'll tell you how to grow your own Babel fish. So it turns out that the metaphor is not really that original, especially if you've seen Sam's talk from IBM about IBM Watson. But still, I'll just very briefly describe what Babel fish actually is. So Babel fish is, unfortunately, a fictional animal from Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy by Douglas Adams. And according to the author, it's a small, yellow, leech-like, and probably the oddest thing in the universe. It feeds on brainwave energy and excretes, long story short, it's a universal translator. The main problem is that you have to actually stick one into your ear to actually make it work. But once you do it, you'll understand anything that is said to you in any language. If you haven't read the book, I really recommend you to. Okay, so moving on. About 2 years ago, I became interested in WebRTC. Thomas Gorrison will give a talk later today about it, so I'll just describe it really briefly. It's an API that allows you to create peer-to-peer connections between devices, not even necessarily just browsers. And you can basically send anything you want for such a connection. You can send audio, video, or data. So about a year ago, I gave a talk about interesting applications of WebRTC, which basically was showing like what cool stuff you can actually build with WebRTC. And I was looking for some applications to show. And the thing is that for data, there are lots of really interesting applications. I mean, WebRTC allows the WebRTC protocol is not based on TCP, but rather UDP. So we can do like very low latency networking. You can do file sharing because you have a direct connection between two devices. You don't have to send the file through some server, like in case of, for example, Dropbox. Maybe some of you have even heard or used my application called ShareDrop, which is a clone of Apple AirDrop, which ironically doesn't work on Safari. But you can actually do like really crazy stuff with WebRTC data channels, like implement BitTorrent protocol in JavaScript. Which works on both server-side and in-browser. And that's exactly what WebTorrent library does. But in case of audio and video, things are more boring. I mean, we have Skype and Hangouts for actually quite some time. And you know, WebRTC allows to do exactly the same without plugins, but it's not really that interesting, right? So I didn't really have anything to show, and I decided to write my own application with a small technical twist. And that's what I'd like to show you today. Okay, so it's time for the demo, so just sit back, relax, and enjoy. Hi, Jane. How are you doing?
Salut, Jane. Comment allez-vous?
Bonjour, Simon. Ça va bien?
Hello, Simon. Things are going well.
Comment vas-tu?
How are you?
Sehr gut. Danke schön.
Très bien. Merci.
Qu'est-ce qui se passe?
Was ist los?
Jestem w trakcie prezentacji.
Je suis lors de la présentation.
Eso es genial.
To świetnie.
Buena suerte.
Powodzenia.
Kiss. Bis lat.
Gracias. Adiós.
Arrivederci.
Bis lat.
Okay, so that's it. Thank you. So as you can see, it's basically a universal translator as well, like just like Biblefish. The thing is that on the left-hand side of your video, you can select the language that you speak in. On the right-hand side, you can see what the language the other person speaks in. And there is one feature that I haven't really shown, is that if the speech recognition is completely messed up, you can just type the message here and it will also be translated and sent to the other person. So it looks like kind of cool, right? But it's actually nothing new. This is a screenshot from a Skype translator by Microsoft. It was released like in December last year, and it does exactly the same thing. It does it even a bit better, because in my application, you have to press the button to actually turn the speech recognition off on. I later describe why it's necessary. In this application, you can just speak all the time, and it will all the time recognize what you're saying. So there are some advantages over Skype, fortunately. The most obvious one is that it works in the browser. Skype Translator is obviously a native application that works only on Windows. It uses open standard, WebRTC and WebSwitch API. Skype uses some proprietary protocols. But to be fair, Microsoft is currently working on a version of Skype that will work in the browser. It will be using the next version of WebRTC. I'm not really sure about Skype Translator, but at least the normal version of Skype should soon work in a browser. But the most important thing I want to say is that it really, the first working version of it took one day to write. And it really shows how powerful today's browsers are and how powerful the APIs are. And it's really not that hard to write something like that. So hopefully you're all wondering how it works. So I'll go over it step by step. Warning, there will be some code ahead, but not much, fortunately. So the first thing is obviously send audio and video, and it's done via WebRTC. So WebRTC is unfortunately not the simplest and easiest API. So I'm using a library to make it much easier. The library that I'm using is called Simple WebRTC. And using it looks like this. So that's like less than 10 lines of code, and that's all you actually need to make your own Skype or very basic version of Skype or Hangouts application. So I'll just go over it very quickly. So first, you just need to instantiate it. Then you just pass IDs of DOM elements where you want to display your video and video of other people. You wait for ready to call event, which is triggered as soon as your browser gets access to your camera and mic. And then you just have to call method join room, which will connect you to all the other peers in the same room. That's actually the most complicated part if you would be using WebRTC directly. And that's just one call in simple WebRTC library. And yeah, that's it. We're actually done with the audio and video part. So moving on to a bit more interesting part, that is speech recognition. It's done using Web Speech Recognition API. And using it looks very similar to the code that we've just seen. Again, you have to instantiate an object. You wait for a result event, which will be triggered whenever the speech recognition actually has some results. And finally, you call method start that will ask for your mic and start the speech recognition. OK, so the next step is that speech recognition gives us a transcript of what you just said. So we need to send it to Google Translate to actually translate it. It's just done using plain AJAX call, so no code here. Once you have the original transcript and its translation, you can send it to the other person. And the cool thing is that we are using WebRTC data channels for that, so you don't need any servers. So normally, you would send it using like AJAX or WebSockets or something like that. But in case of when we are using WebRTC, we have direct connection with the other person. We don't need any server for that. So using data channels is fortunately really, really easy. You have just one method, send directly to all. You specify the channel name, what your payload name, which is basically what you're sending, and the data itself. And yeah, that's it. So the last step is, so we already have like the original and translated transcript on the other side. And now it's time to read it out loud. And we use, again, Web Speech API for that. This time it's called Web Speech Synthesis API. And it looks like that. You have like this really strange object. You just have to instantiate. You set the language. You set the message itself. And then you have this And then you have this speak method where you have to just pass this object to. And yeah, that's actually it. As you can see, hopefully, the individual steps of it are really, really simple. In the real application, there's a bit more code, for example, for code handling, for handling language switches, and so on. But yeah, that's actually the core of it. There's not really that much code in the real application. If anyone is interested in the actual code, I'll give a link to the code at the end of the talk. OK, so the second part. So I'd like to give you like very, very brief introduction to Web Switch API. Actually, I just wanted to mention just two things. So the first thing is that Web Switch API recognition has two modes. The first one is one-shot, and the second one is continuous. In one-shot mode, the speech recognition algorithm will stop whenever you make a pause, which is great for giving simple commands or filling out really short text inputs. And that's the mode that is used in my application. The other mode, which is more interesting, is the continuous mode. And basically, it will, even if you make a pause, it will just continue to work, at least in theory. So this one is great for dictating stuff, or for my application, would be at least, where two users have a conversation. Yeah, unfortunately, it doesn't really work that well. And I'll tell why really soon. So the second thing is that according to the spec, the API itself is like agnostic of the underlying speech recognition implementation. So it basically doesn't implement, it doesn't specify how the speech recognition should work. And you can have speech recognition on the server or on the client. So in Chrome, it uses Google services, so it's on the server. But it could be done locally. So why the speech API is really awesome? It has some issues. So if you'd like to experiment with it, I'll just briefly describe what the issues are, so at least you know what to expect. So the first issue is that the speech recognition will stop if you just talk for too long. I'm not sure what the exact limit is, but if you talk for like a minute or over a minute, it will just stop. You'll get an abort. You'll get abort event. And yeah, that's actually it. The second issue is actually quite opposite. It will stop if you don't talk for too long. I'm talking about the continuous mode, which should handle pauses. But if you make a long enough pause, it will just stop. Again, you'll get abort event. And there is a workaround for these issues. I mean, you can wait for the abort event and just call start again. But unfortunately, in some cases, after you call start, it will abort again, and you'll just end up in this infinite loop, which is, makes the application really unstable. And actually, that's the reason why my application doesn't use the continuous mode. So the most important issue, I think, is that Web Speech API doesn't work with WebRTC media streams. So the thing is that Web Speech API specification was created probably before WebRTC specification. That's why it doesn't really mention anything about media streams. And it means that this Web Speech API can only recognize input from your own mic, nothing else, really. And that causes a lot of issues. So the first thing is that, for example, in my application, which uses WebRTC and Web Speech Recognition API, it will ask you twice for your mic, which is really confusing for users. So once it will ask for WebRTC, the second time for the Web Speech API. But the most important thing is that, like I said, it can only recognize what you're saying. You can't get like remote audio stream from another person and just pass it, it into Web Speech Recognition object, right? So if you could do it, you could basically just write an extension or a plugin to any WebRTC application and just perform the whole recognition of whatever other person has said locally on your computer, which would be really cool. Another thing is, I'm not sure if you're aware, but using WebRTC, you can actually make phone calls. You can make or receive phone calls. You have to use a gateway service like Twilio, for example, but it's possible. And if you could pass like remote audio to speech recognition, you could actually, for example, make an application where you can just call somebody, take audio from them, and just pass it through speech recognition locally. So it would be pretty awesome application for example, people with hearing loss, which could basically create a transcript of a phone call on the fly. So yeah, unfortunately, it doesn't work. But Like I said, this web speech spec doesn't really mention anything about it, but actually it would be really easy to extend the specification without breaking it. Done. That's it. You just have to pass audio stream to this web to the speech recognition object, and it could just work. So that's actually what Firefox is doing right now. They are extending, I hope at least, they are extending this API a bit without breaking it, actually. I was just told that it should work in Firefox OS 2.5, so hopefully we'll see it soon. And like the most obvious reason why this API is not really more popular, it works only in Chrome. And the issue is that it's not even like all Chrome, desktop, and mobile. The issue is that, for example, there is a small bug in mobile version of Chrome, which doesn't allow you to use speech recognition if you're using WebRTC at the same time. So unfortunately, my app won't work on Android. But what can we do about these issues, right? I mean, the first is we can ask W3C nicely to update the spec. We can ask Google to fix the implementation. Or we could ask another browser vendor to actually implement Web Speech API. And while the speech recognition itself is a really, really complicated problem, technology is not really an issue here. Personal assistants or virtual assistants are really popular lately. And like, it turns out that every browser vendor actually has some implementation of it. So Google obviously has Google Now. Microsoft has Cortana and Skype Translate. Apple has Siri. Firefox actually doesn't have anything, but they are using a library called Pocket Sphinx, which does the speech recognition locally on the device. But there is also another way. We don't really need to wait for browser vendors. So you probably remember this one, right? So all the time I'm talking about the native implementation of the API. But it's actually possible to create a third-party library that would have exactly the same API as Web Speech API, and just would use some third-party service to perform the speech recognition, or do it locally. So again, like I said, the speech recognition is like a really complex and hard problem. But again, as it turns out, there are plenty of companies that actually have it already. So Facebook has recently announced Facebook M Assistant, yet another. So they also obviously have technology for speech recognition. There is another assistant called Hound by SoundHound. I'm not sure if you've heard about it, but it looks really promising. Chinese giant Baidu has announced Duer recently. There are some non-web companies that do speech recognition, obviously, like Nuance. And there is also, we've just seen a demo, there is IBM Watson, which also has API for performing speech recognition. And finally, there's an interesting project called Pocket Sphinx JS, which basically takes the Pocket Sphinx library that is used by Firefox, like I just mentioned. And it compiles it using MScripts into JavaScript. And this actually provides the fully functional speech recognition library in your browser, in actually any browser that supports WebRTC. It doesn't have to support speech recognition natively. So that's actually it. I kind of hope that you saw that, you know, the whole implementation wasn't really that hard. Each individual step was really easy. You could see that we have like today's browsers are really, really powerful, and I strongly encourage you to, you know, maybe instead of writing yet another framework, just try to experiment with them. Also, I kind of hope that once Firefox actually releases a version that of their browser that has a Web Speech implementation API, I mean Web Speech API implementation, it will just become more popular. So again, my name is Szymon Nowak. You can find me at Szymek. I work at these companies. Yeah, and that's all. Thank you.